Henry Moe playing on an upright bass. I didn't even know you could play that song on an upright bass. This is Henry's last week with us until he is back from college in the fall. We will miss Henry. Welcome to Pentecost Sunday. It is so great to see all of you. If you are joining us online, thank you so much for joining us, for worshiping with us. We are so glad that everyone is here. Would you stand with us, please? Another.
see you all this morning. Thank you for joining us for worship on this Pentecost Sunday. We have a very special guest. Everybody okay over there? We have a special guest I'll introduce in just a moment. But before that, we have a couple of announcements. One is the Connect card. If you are a guest or if you're a regular attender at North Sound, we use Connect cards to...
Connect.
Yeah, that's good. It's an IQ test here this morning. And so if you're a guest, it helps us to be able to get to know you, and we can send you the weekend news so you know what's coming up. And for everyone, including guests but regular attenders, it's a great place to put prayer requests because we remember those on Tuesday in staff meeting, and they're sent out to the elders. So hope that you will... you'll let us know so we can connect. And we also want to remind you that this summer we got a couple of things going on for our kids. The younger kids have a Run to Win camp. I think it's about $125, a youth camp is about $250. And last year, you guys really did a wonderful job in helping to sponsor children. If you would like to do so again, you can just follow the instructions up there and help us in that way. We would appreciate that. And then finally, we have a young man that we want to honor who is a graduate. Is it high school, Dan? Is that? Oh, let me see, Dan. We got, where did you graduate from high school?
Christian High School in San Diego.
In San Diego. And then college?
UC Irvine.
UC Irvine. And then what school did you recently graduate from, Dan?
Not the Cougars.
No, apparently no. Not. But we love the Cougars, right? Yeah. You better say that or I'm going to be in deep trouble. So, Dan, tell us what your... It's a master's degree and it's in...
Computer science and engineering.
Computer science and engineering. And so you can work on computers and build things.
Yes.
Is that right?
Okay. Yes, that
okay.
would be, yeah.
Good. And how will that help you moving ahead in your job, your new degree?
So I work for Dell Technologies, and I like my current job, so I'm...
Good. Are you going to get more pay for a higher degree?
It kind of is a meritocracy. You get more pay by...
By producing
earning
more.
It.
Good.
Yes. Yeah.
Good. Kind of like ministry.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's kind of how it goes.
Yeah. Okay. Good. Well, we have a book for you, and Pastor Robin also has a gift for you. This is by Mark Batterson called All In. And would you join me in congratulating Dan? I don't know if Jeannie, are you in this service? There you are, Jeannie. Stand up. Stand up. Well, you have to get congratulations along. Yes, the whole family, of course. Of course, Mark too. So, Jordan, Keith, Bonnie. So, Mark, are you the dad?
I am.
Oh, congratulations! So this is Jordan, Keith, Bonnie. Mark is his dad, and Jeannie is grandma. And he just graduated from the United States Naval Academy, and. He, I found out at the break, would like to be a pilot and is planning to go to Pensacola for that kind of a training. How convenient when Top Gun has just come out. I don't know if you all know it, but Top Gun came out in 1986, and the applicants for Naval Flight School just went like this. Folks wanted to participate in that, and so we congratulate Jordan on behalf of North Sound. My first job in the Navy was actually at the Naval Academy. I told the folks in the first service that one of the fun things, being there when the plebes arrived, that is the kids that are coming out of high school and are coming in, they come in with their civilian clothes and they go into the gym and they move along with their box and they get all of the stuff that they need and then they get in uniform. And then they head over to the barber shop, and that was one of the more interesting places. The barbers at the Naval Academy needed about as much talent as my barber does for my hair. So anyway, We have a very special guest. As you know, at North Sound, we don't spread our missions giving real wide. We tend to do it in a very focused way. And it's not that doing it wide is bad, it's just not how we've chosen to do it. We've chosen to go deep. And we have gone deep with someone that we trust so very much that we are in partnership with, and that is Dr. Finney Philip in Udaipur, India. So we have been involved as a church in multiple projects. We've been involved for years now in supporting the Bible College and Seminary, so we provide a monthly gift for the operations of that school so that they can offer to the students the lowest possible price for their education there. Then we have also been involved in humanitarian efforts with Dr. Finney. Most recently, we have been involved with the work in with the COVID situation there. And we'll talk a little bit more about our engagement later because we're going to do the service just a little bit different today. We're going to have an opportunity for our friends online to join us through this service. And then for those of you that are in the room, we're going to have a little time afterwards where Dr. Finney will share with us as well as a special feature for those of you that are in the room. So Dr. Finney, we are delighted to have you. Finney has become my friend in addition to the work that we do overseas. He's a Langham Scholar, which means that the John Stott organization, the Langham Trust, brought him from India, as they do a number of young men and women around the world, and give them an outstanding education in England, in his case, a PhD in New Testament at the University of Durham. And then the expectation of the Langham Trust is that they will go back and do the work that they're called to do. And Finney has a number of other connections in a larger community that, again, we'll talk about a little bit later. So would you join me as Dr. Finney comes to share with us this morning?
Thank you all for allowing me to be here today and to be enjoying the friendship and fellowship that the Lord has built over the years. I always feel that it is at home at North Sound. And this Wednesday night I came, and throughout these days, morning, breakfast, lunch, dinner, everything we have packed up with, meeting up with friends. Thank you so much for your hospitality, love, and your generosity. We just want to appreciate how much it makes a difference to the people on the ground. More of that we can talk after the service. This morning the Lord has put in my heart to speak about Peter. And I want to focus your attention to Gospel of John chapter 21, verses 17, and it says, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was hurt because Jesus asked the third time, "Do you love me?" He said, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." Today is the day of Pentecost, and we celebrate the coming of the Holy Spirit, the shaping of the church, the formation of the church, bringing together diverse people as one. You hear the sound and the voice and the fire, you know, depicting God's covenant for God's people. And then we also know that many people from different nations come together, you know, on that day because God loves the nation. That is the second level in which we understand Pentecost. And the third thing that we can immediately look at Pentecost and say that Peter was very confident in telling the story about Jesus Christ. "You who crucified is the Lord, now risen, resurrected, and he is alive. He is the Lord now." Confidence about the centrality of Jesus Christ in their lives. And finally, the formation of the community, the fellowship, sharing together, partnering together, worshiping together, studying the Word of God together. So that is Pentecost. We love Pentecost. We love the image, you know, the picture of the Spirit coming down into this world. But I want to take you further, you know, before what happened, you know, what happened to Peter just before he stood up there. What was he before he actually experienced the Pentecost? I think that will help us to understand our own situation and to enjoy the value of Pentecost in our own personal life. One of the beauty about the scripture that we have, 66 books that we hold, is being organized in a very systematic way. Many times it is not chronologically it's been arranged, but it is arranged in terms of the interconnection of the message that is mentioned here. If you ask if it's a chronological, then Mark should have been the first one. So Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and then you go to Acts, and then you go to Paul's letters. Paul's letters, again, it's not chronologically arranged. The biggest one in the front and the shortest one at the end, Philemon. And why Matthew is organized immediately after the Old Testament? Because Matthew beautifully connects the Old Testament to Jesus. So there is that sequencing of things that the Holy Spirit has done through the canonization, through the way in which it is laid down. And we need to appreciate what God does through the writer and those who decide to put the Bible together as one. Now, why I'm saying this is because John, as the beloved disciple of Jesus, writing this gospel in a beautiful way. His theme is very clear in the gospel. He uses the term Jesus Christ about 170 times and believing 100 times, which means that believing in Jesus is the main theme of this gospel. And if you come to chapter 20 of John and verse 31, it says, "But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing in you may have life in his name." As an author, he has done a perfect conclusion there. He has completed the whole story and came with that sharp summary of his thesis. But then he doesn't stop there. He moves to another 25 verses, another chapter that is being presented to us. And that is very significant for me to share with you what the Spirit of God has put in my heart, because we are thinking about the day of Pentecost. What happened before Pentecost? And John chapter 21 is crucial. And if you read that, it is very important to know that it's a story of our dear friend Peter. Peter's story. John, Peter, and other apostles were picked up by Jesus from their own place. If you read Gospel of John, the first two chapters, you will know that, you know, John came to know about Jesus through John the Baptist. He said that this is the Lamb of God. And Jesus said, "Let me go and check." And then he goes, and then he says that, "Jesus, where are you staying? I just want to join. I just want to be part of it." You know, we don't see Jesus saying, "Come and follow me." But John is saying that I went and followed him. That's his heart. But if you look at the story of Peter, you know, Andrew takes Peter to Jesus, and then Jesus telling Peter, "You follow me." So there is a difference in the calling in which they have come. But over the years, they became good friends. And John has such a beautiful heart. You know, if you read one of those epistles, he will say, "Little children." That's the heart of a father. He would speak in those lines. If you read Matthew, Mark, and Luke, you will not see the story of Peter like this. You miss that story. But it is so important to see John under the Holy Spirit, direction of the Spirit, picks up the story of Peter's restoration towards Jesus Christ. And that is the crucial thing I just want to share this morning. If John was not there, we would have missed the story of Peter's restoration to Jesus. We will have an incomplete picture of Peter, one side he has denied Jesus Christ, and the other side he's standing on the pulpit preaching on the day of Pentecost. What made it happen was a friend like John. There is a friend in the life of Peter who was ready to write a chapter of his life and tell the world, although this man was a failure, although this man has denied Jesus 3 times, this is a story, this is an internal story, this is a friendly story I want to share to all, that he was restored back to Jesus. And that's why he is now preaching on the day of Pentecost. This morning, this is an important principle and a value as church. We need to take it seriously. We needed people like John who would look at our lives and say, let me add a chapter into your life. You may be broken. You may be guilty-ridden. You might have denied of your friendship and you're running alone. Let me come near you. Let me tell that story again. Let me tell your restoration story, and that will keep you back on the pulpit. Dear friends, this is what Jesus is looking for. As a community, North Sound, you need friends like John. Or you can be like John, looking at others and picking them up and help them to move forward. So an important thing, people like John helped Peter to move forward. But it was Jesus who actually made the difference into their life. We need people, great friends like John, but it is Jesus who does the work in the life of people. A few things I just want to pick up so that God will work in our hearts so that we can be enjoying the Pentecost and the work of the Spirit in our lives. Chapter 21 begins with saying that Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Galilee. And there are about 7 disciples. You don't know what happened to the rest? 11 out of the 11, 7 are here. We read in Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28, verse 10, Jesus, resurrected Jesus, telling the women that you go and tell the brothers that I'm going to meet them in Galilee. They received that word, but in between, Jesus might have met them privately, individually, but brothers meeting together in Galilee. So I believe that these disciples were in Galilee region, maybe wandering in the mountainous regions and waiting for Jesus. When will he come? Waiting, waiting. And then naturally, when you get bored, you will get engaged in something, isn't it? Many times we accuse Peter, oh, this guy has gone back to his old job. No, I think it was not just going backsliding into an old job. Rather, he was getting busy when he was waiting. Busy when he was waiting. Many times in our own personal lives, we wait, wait, wait for God's answer, but you then slowly engage with things. But I think it was crucial for Peter to go back to the fishing so that Jesus can do a new work in his life. So don't just lie down on the mounts of Galilee and relax and be lazy and sit there. Engage in something if you are not clear about what is happening around you. Engage in something so that Jesus can come and say to you, put the net on the other side. So this morning, that is what was happening in the life of Peter. Peter and the disciples didn't know that Jesus was around. Maybe it was so dim, it was early morning, you didn't know who is on the shore. But one thing Jesus asked them was, children, do you have anything? And they said, nothing, nothing. It's very important for us to know that in our situations, in our busyness, many times we forget that Jesus is with us in our situations. Our eyes sometimes are blurred with our own busyness, our own things that we focus on. And many times we need someone or Jesus to come and touch us and show us what to do. And when Jesus asked this question, have you caught anything? They said, no. Many times good questions from God helps us. Our questions normally, why God? All the time our questions are there. But then when God is interested in putting some questions towards us, that would bring some answers into our life. It will help us to face our failures, our own challenges in our lives. An important thing what these disciples did as Jesus was restoring them back to a position where they can wait for the Holy Spirit to come was that he asked them to cast the net on the right side. That's a very important, interesting way in which Jesus engages with his people. Now, I believe that normally it would be on the left side. I believe that it is the left side is the usual way, the comfortable way of fishing. The difference between the left side and the right side is only about 7 feet, the width of the boat. And so if there was fish, the fish could have been in the left side when they were fishing earlier. But the difference is when Jesus said, come on, try on the other side. I think that's a kind of obedience Jesus is asking us to do. The kind of obedience in which it's a short span, but even can you obey me into move to that short span where my space is in your life? That short span, maybe you're busy with your own thing, but see what is that shorter span in which God is asking you to fish again, put the net again. And that brings wonderful results in the life of people who are with him. I think that is the kind of obedience that will help us to enjoy coming back and to be in that Pentecost experience. Another thing that we learn from this story is, I'm just summarizing it, that Jesus is saying to them, okay, you got 153 big fishes. Why don't you come and have fellowship with me? And by the time they come with their own fish, Jesus is already having a fish ready, prepared, you know, barbecuing or whatever that you can call it. Jesus is ready with his fish to their fish. Isn't that amazing to see how Jesus wants us to involve with the things that he is doing around us? Jesus is offering them fire. Peter just jumped into the water in the early mornings and he's cold, freezing maybe. And Jesus is saying, come on, come to my warmth, the warmth of the Spirit, the warmth of my fellowship. Peter may be thinking about the fire, oh, the day I denied him, I was around the fire. But today's fire is quite different. This is the fire that will warm our hearts. And the other thing that we need to remember is that when Jesus was inviting them to be in fellowship with them, and normally in those in the Mediterranean region, if you invite someone to come and have a breakfast or a lunch or a dinner, it means that there is forgiveness. We have opened our hearts. We have forgiven the past life situations, and now we are together. That's what Jesus was doing when Peter was invited, or the other believers, other disciples were invited to join. It was a moment of restoration. And then we have this conversation between Peter and Jesus that's going on. And in that conversation, 3 times Jesus is asking, and Peter is trying to affirm his love for Jesus. And those we have heard many sermons about the agape and phileo kind of terminologies that I use there. But I just want to pick up one particular aspect of it. Three times Jesus is asking, Peter, do you sacrificially love me like God loves me? Agape, do you love me with an agape love? And Peter's response is, Jesus, I admire you. Phileo, that's what he says. Second time, Jesus asking him, do you have a sacrificial love for me? Peter says, no, I admire you, Jesus. But the third time, Jesus is not asking agape, he's saying, Phileo, are you admiring me? Do you admire me, Peter? That is where Peter got hurt. He was broken. Jesus coming down to the level of Peter to lift him up into the love of God. That is what restoration of fellowship with Jesus is all about. That is why we are sitting together as a body of Christ, celebrating his coming down, his humility to reach out to us and to lift us up from the situations that are hurting us, we are going through. So Peter was challenged by these questions. This morning, again, reminding ourselves about the day of Pentecost, it's a restoration day. It's a restoration of the humanity back into the purposes of God. The distinctions of the division of the language, the Babel, has now become one language in the spirit. It was a day when the nations began to come together. It was a day when the Gentiles being added, you know, gathered or into coming into that opening up of things began to happen. But it happened because something happened before. Something preceded for God to be preparing his church and his people for a new season. And that preparation happens with people like John standing with us and Jesus continue to work in our restoration towards him. This morning, the call for all of us is, can I be a John? Can I be a person who can add a chapter into the life of the other? Or can someone come and help me like John? I'm really down. I'm really lonely. I need help. I've denied Jesus. I betrayed him. I'm busy with my own things. Is there a John who can come and help me? That makes church beautiful. That makes each one of us important for the kingdom of God. But beyond that, there is Jesus who is always there to affirm us, to restore us, to put us into the right places where he can say that, well done, my brothers and sisters, you can move ahead in the power of the Holy Spirit. The church united can conquer this world. The church together in the Spirit of God can stand against the evils of this world. And I pray that this word will encourage each one of us to move forward in the Lord. Shall we bow our heads? Father, we thank you for this wonderful time together, listening to your word. And I pray that as you help Peter to move and other disciples to move into your things, as ready for Pentecost and the building up of your church, Father, I pray that that element, that aspect, you release this morning into us, into this church of God. I pray for John, the beloved disciple kind of people in the congregation, and those who are looking for help, I pray that this will be the day in which you will do that. Father, I pray that your continuous presence, Father, from our comfortable zone to 7.5 feet of discomfort or a change of perception, Father, I pray that you bring that to us so that we will align ourselves to your purposes, O God. Father, as we come as a body of Christ and we move into the Lord's Supper, I pray that your Spirit will continue to minister to us. We bless you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Dr. Finney. I hope you enjoyed those words as I did. What a great reminder in a season where tensions between folks, tensions between Americans, tensions between folks even in churches has been so strong, a reminder of our role as being a friend to each other. Thank you so much for that this morning. And the reason that we can do that is because of what we have before us here. We recognize the fact that the ground at the foot of the cross is level, meaning we all come on the same basis. We're all sinners. We are saved only by God's grace. And as we take our communion, we are reminded of that, that it's only because of our Lord's broken body and shed blood that we have the relationships that we do here in this room and with our Lord. And so today, as we come to the table, we are reminded about those relationships. And we take a few moments before communion to look at our vertical relationship, that is our relationship with God, and ask ourselves the question, is, are things right with the Lord in our lives? And if not, we have in this moment an opportunity to make them right. And we also have an opportunity to look at our horizontal relationships, our relationships with other folks, and see whether things are the way they should be there as well, so that we can engage and move forward on the basis of the kind of love and friendship that Finney shared with us this morning. So I'm going to invite you to stand with me if you would. And in the quietness of our own hearts, we're going to take a look at that vertical and horizontal relationship, make sure things are right there, and then we will continue together with a corporate prayer of confession. So friends, let's humbly confess our sins to Almighty God. Let's join together in the corporate prayer of confession. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and earnestly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, our heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The words of institution for our service of communion are found in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. And we read there the words that Paul intended for the church way back in Corinth in those days in the first century, and now some 2,000 years, we continue the recognition of what the Lord has done for us in providing the means by which our sins are forgiven, the wonder of the cross, and the future of eternal life. We read these words, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you for your body broken for us and for your blood shed for us. Lord, it's the simple truth of the gospel that you so love the world that you gave your one and only Son, that whoever believes in him would not perish but have everlasting life. We thank you, Lord, for that truth today and pray that you would help us to live that out with joy. In Jesus' name, amen. We invite you to join us for communion. If you're a follower of Jesus Christ, it would be great to have you. We'll start over with this section here, and I will serve this section and then move over here and then finally to the outside section.
Sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes
Lord, we thank you that we can come into your presence and offer you blessing and glory and honor. Lord, how grateful we are that you have chosen us to be people of your kingdom. And Lord, we're reminded that your kingdom is a place of righteousness, peace, and joy. Lord, we're called to be agents of your kingdom, and so I pray that you would help us to do our part to turn an evil world to rights, that righteousness would prevail, the world living as it should be, right as it should be, Lord, that we would do our part in each of our ways. Lord, you also have called us as agents of your kingdom to be people of peace. Lord, we're reminded of the terrible conflict that continues in Ukraine, and we pray for peace. Lord, we pray for a miraculous shortcut to a solution where the bloodshed will cease. We pray that for the other areas of the world, Lord, where open conflict rages. Pray for peace, Lord, for our own nation, where for many, political identity seems to have stripped the identity that we have in you as followers of Jesus Christ, as agents of the kingdom. Lord, may we live as citizens of your kingdom and as resident aliens of this world. Help us, Lord, however, to do our part in this world, in all of the processes, including political processes, to see your kingdom come and your will be done. And Lord, we're reminded that your kingdom is not only a kingdom of righteousness and peace, but of joy. And I pray for my brothers and sisters that as we leave this place, you would help us to be a people of joy, experiencing it in our own lives and with contagion, giving that joy to others. Even as we join together in the prayer you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. I'm going to offer the benediction, but also ask you if you could just be seated after the benediction. Appreciate that. And now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us this day and forevermore. Amen.